are expressed by the speakers, and thereafter an interaction starts, so that a lot of thoughts will be shared, a lot of new ideas will come. And I thought the most appropriate, in so far as this issue is concerned, will be section 112 of the Evidence Act, which provision has been disturbing me for quite some time now. So with these few words, I would start the proceedings. So the way it is going to go is that I am going to talk about my views on section 112 and its relevancy in today's scenario, where there is so much of scientific development. And I want to really focus on 112 and see whether 112, as it stands today, is in line with the scientific development which has happened since the enactment in the year 1872. So therefore, I want to focus on insisting that this 112, section 112 of the Evidence Act requires a complete revamping, and therefore I will be giving my thoughts on that. And after I complete it, retired Justice Nagamuthu will express his opinions about it. And thereafter, Mr. Srinivasa Raghavan will pitch in. And we want thereafter questions from the participants on their thoughts and what is that they want to say about it, or if they have any questions, they can pose those questions. So this is broadly the format that is going to be adopted in the today's webinar. I would want to start this webinar by bringing to all your notice Article 51 capital A of the Constitution of India. This, I think, is one of the most important articles that actually came into the Constitution after nearly 27 years after the Constitution came into force. This came nearly after 27 years. This came only in the year with effect from 3/1/1977. But I find this article to be really, really important, because people who are all talking about enforcement of rights must first comply with Article 51A before even they open their mouth on the rights about which they are talking, because 51A basically talks about fundamental duties of every citizen of this country. I was really, really interested in going through this article. In this article, one article which has a lot of significance for all these types of webinars, etc., is 51AJ. 51AJ says, I will read, it shall be the duty of every citizen of India to strive towards excellence in all spheres of individual and collective activity, so that the nation constantly rises to higher levels of endeavor and achievement. The whole concept of these webinars, the whole concept of the expressing or spreading knowledge is for what? Is we are all striving towards that excellence. We are all striving towards excellence in our given sphere. Our given sphere is the institution, namely the judiciary, and all our collective activity will have to take the judiciary to a higher level, which ultimately will build a lot of strength to one of the most important organs of this country. So therefore, I wanted to start this webinar by quoting Article 51AJ to all of you, to understand that it is the duty of every citizen to strive for this excellence. So with keeping that in mind, I will get into the topic which has been assigned for the discussion. The topic that has been assigned for the discussion is with regard to Section 112 of the Evidence Act. Whenever I read 112 of the Evidence Act, a very famous expression which all of you know comes to my mind, which is, maternity is always certain, but paternity is a matter of inference only. I'll again repeat, maternity is always certain, paternity is a matter of inference. This is the background of 112. So before going into 112, it becomes important for us to just touch upon section 4 and then go into 112 because of the usage of one very important expression in section 112. So section 4 talks about three expressions, three important expressions, which are may presume, shall presume, and conclusive proof. My dear young friends, it's very important to understand the significance of this word presume or presumption. What is permitted in law is not mere assumptions. What is permitted in law is not mere presumptions. What is permitted in law is actually the legal assumption. The legal assumption, which wordings you will find under section 114 of the Evidence Act. So this presumption will fall within three brackets, which will be may presume, shall presume, and conclusive proof. Insofar as may presume is concerned, I would not want to read into the definition because it will take a lot of time. Insofar as may presume is concerned, here, wherever it is provided that the court may presume what? A fact, then what is important is that discretion is given to the court to either take it, to either presume it, or ask the other, or permit the other side to rebut it. So a discretion is vested with the court either to presume it and also permit the other side to rebut such a presumption. So that is the purport of may presume. Then comes shall presume. So wherever the expression shall presume comes, the court is not given that discretion. The court shall presume that fact. Shall presume that fact. Of course, having regard to the fact as proof, that is a very important expression both in may and shall. It has to be, presumption shall be having regard to the fact as proof. That is very important. So the court here, when it comes within the bracket of shall presume, it shall presume a fact. It is not given the discretion, but the rebuttal, right of rebuttal, is given to the other side here also. So the difference between a may presume and shall presume is, in a may presume, the court is given the discretion. In shall presume, the court is not given the discretion, but it is always open to the other side to rebut that presumption. This shall presume is an expression which you will find in many provisions like 304B of the Indian Penal Code, section 139 of the Negotiable Instruments Act, section 29 and 30 of the POCSO Act, etc., etc. You will find it in a lot of enactments. So that is the purport of the word shall presume. The most important expression, which is very relevant for today's discussion, is conclusive proof. Is conclusive proof. Carefully now read conclusive. I'm going to read the definition of conclusive proof as found in section 4. Section 4 says, when one fact is declared by this act to be conclusive proof of another, the court shall, on proof of the one fact, regard the other as proof, and shall not, underline the word, and shall not allow evidence to be given for the purpose of disproving it. Every word is important. Every word here is important. So, a reading of this term conclusive proof shows that there is where if a fact is proof, if one fact declared by this act to be conclusive shall on the proof of one fact. So, by proof of a fact, the it is presumed that it has been proved and there is no question of rebutting it at all. So the expression conclusive proof basically puts a lid on rebuttal itself, the moment a fact is proved. So now, having this in our mind, let us get into section 112 of the Evidence Act, which is what we are going to discuss today. 112 of the Evidence Act first reads as follows. I'll read it. The fact that any person was born during the continuance of a valid marriage between his mother and any man, one, or within 280 days after its dissolution. This is the second thing. The mother remaining unmarried shall be a conclusive proof that he is the legitimate son of that man, unless it can be shown that the parties to the marriage had no access to each other at any time when he could have been begotten. Now, if you carefully read this provision 112, there was a meaning as to why it was brought within the statute book. First, I will go into that, and thereafter I will try to dissect this provision. There was a reason why it came into the statute book, and the reason is that the public policy always demands the unity of a family. Unity of a family. Family is the unit which is the most fundamental thing which has sustained the culture of this country. A family, therefore, preserving the unit of the family is one of the most important safeguard that has to be given. And that is the safeguard which is given under section 112. The other concept which comes out of it is, the law presumes against the vice and immorality. The law has always presumes against what? Against vice and immorality. This is the other thing. So, this please remember that this law came in the year 1872. Came into force in the year 1872. Have in your mind that 1872 was a period where there was practice of polygamy and there was absolutely no scientific method available to disprove the paternity or the legitimacy of a child. So please bear this in mind when and it is from here I am going to expand it. So this came into existence. In fact, in one of the commentary which I read on 112, they said that the Britishers used to travel overseas and they used to be away from the family. And therefore, it became very important since they had no access to the wife, to the woman during the particular point of time. This presumption was brought into. This is one of the theory. This is one of the commentary that has been written by somebody. So therefore, what is important to understand is that this provision came into force at a time where there was no scientific development, where there was a practice of polygamy, where the woman's right was at its lowest ebb. Please bear this in mind. So if you look at this, there are two things which comes out of reading section 112. The first thing that comes out is that the fact that a person was born during the continuance of a valid marriage. So one is, the first presumption here is the child that was born during a valid marriage between two persons. Second is 280 days after its dissolution. So where a marriage gets dissolved, but after the dissolution, within the 280 days after the dissolution, if a child is born, then again, it will be the conclusive proof that it is the legitimate child. So there are two possibilities that has been contemplated 112. One, while there is a valid marriage. Two, while there is a dissolution of the marriage. So these are the two things. Now, when we were dealing with conclusive proof, it read as if the lid is closed, that you cannot let in anything. But if you carefully read section 112, there is a small window that is open here, which is that it is possible to prove that there was no access between the husband and wife. Please read the last sentence. Unless it can be shown that the parties to the marriage had no access to each other at any time when he could have been begotten. So access was the only test, only proof that is required. Once access is shown, then the presumption becomes a conclusive proof. You cannot prove, rebut anything otherwise. So that small window that is open under 112 is to prove or disprove that access. That is the only thing. Now, developing it from here, you will find that the issue is whether it is, what is safeguarded, whether paternity is safeguarded or legitimacy is safeguarded. That's one thought which came in my mind. A reading of the provision shows what is safeguarded more, at least pronounced in the provision, is legitimacy. What comes to my mind is that why not paternity? Take the case of an adoption. In a case of an adoption, the adoptive father, the child is the legitimate child of the adoptive father. But when it comes to the paternity, the man can always say that it was not born to me. There is the difference. Please understand the difference between the paternity and the legitimacy. This issue was not gone into in many judgments in India. There is only one judgment I found where there, interestingly, this issue has been gone into, which is the judgment of Tiwari, which is the citation I give. Just go through this judgment. It is very interesting. It is Manupatra, Delhi. Where the case number is 3701 of 2010. The Justice Ravindra Bhatt, as he then was, had delivered this judgment. It is really a very interesting judgment where he talks about the importance of paternity, whereas the focus of 112 is only legitimacy of a child. So, the next thing which comes to my mind is as between presumption and a fact. If you read 112, what happens is that presumption takes over a fact which is otherwise not correct. Here, the presumption dominates a fact which can be otherwise proved through scientific methods. So, what is this access? So, before I venture into explaining this, we must understand what is this access about which this 112 is talking about. The access about which the 112 is talking about is the physical proximity of a man and a woman. Whether there was a physical proximity between a man and a woman, that's the only test for access. If that physical proximity is proved, then thereafter there is no question of trying to prove anything else against it. So, what is that physical proximity? The physical proximity is that since they had an opportunity to be together, there is a chance of a physical intercourse between both of them. Therefore, the child that was born to them is the legitimate child. So, access was understood by many judgments to be a physical proximity between a man and woman. Nobody knows what actually is happening inside the bedroom. And law would not want to peep in and see what is happening in the bedroom. So, therefore, they have very thoughtfully interpreted the axis as a physical proximity as between a man and a woman. I had the advantage of reading one judgment of the Canada Supreme Court, which is reported in 1952, volume one, Supreme Court reports. There they don't call it as India, Canada, they call it Supreme Court reports. See, what will happen in this case is, it's very interesting. What will happen in this case is, please understand, at the time when this provision came into force, even contraceptive was not available. No contraceptive was available. In this case, what would have happened is that there would have been a dispute between the parties with regard to the legitimacy of a son. The man will say, it is true that we had access, but whenever we had intercourse, I was using contraceptive. This was one view that was thrown up open in that particular judgment. So the court went into this issue and said that there is an opportunity for a sexual intercourse between the two persons. But what happens where they have used a contraceptive? So, but if you juxtapose it to Indian context, all this will not work at all. The husband cannot be heard to say that it is true that I had access to my wife, but I used contraceptive. Therefore, there was no question of my wife bearing a child. Therefore, this is not my child. It cannot be done. Why? Because what is expected to be proved under section 112 is access. The moment you prove that there was access, whether you used contraceptive, whether you were able to begot, all that vanishes, because a rebuttal is not permitted, and what is contemplated 112 is a conclusive proof once the access is proved. Then, so therefore I said that the access, I am repeating at the risk of repetition, access means physical proximity or an opportunity for the parties to have physical sexual intercourse. This is how access must be understood. So I thought that with the improvement in scientific technology and scientific developments, there is an injustice of a presumption which is overwhelming a justice of fact. There is an injustice on the part of this presumption, this conclusive proof presumption, which is actually overwhelming a justice of the fact. Please understand what happens to the individual man's right to establish that he was not the one who fathered the child. Just because you are able to prove access, what happens if the man is very clear about it, the woman is very clear about it, but the law is also very clear about it, which says that access, conclusive proof, you have any explanation, we will not even hear it. So what is now available? There is a fact that is available with that man to show that it is not his child, but the man had an access. Therefore, there is a presumption that it is conclusive proof. Whatever fact you have it with yourself. Court will not look into it. That is how 112 is read now. Now, you must also understand the fact that by scientific advancement, today, there are repeated judgments of the courts and also from the science faculties that the DNA test is 99.999% valid.
Accurate.
Accuracy of a DNA test has been established beyond any doubts in this case. So there is a test which is available today, which is called as a DNA test. There is one very interesting judgment which I read in the English law reports. That is a case where there is a white man and a white woman. This white man and the white woman gave birth to a black child. So what happened was the court analyzed that here is a white man and a white woman, and their lineage shows that they have always been in white families only, but here is a black child which has come. There, interestingly, one quote from the Singapore High Court is made, where one man, party in person, said, when he argued a case something like this, he had said, when I plant an apple tree, I expect apples from it and I cannot get onions from it. Is how he was putting it in a layman's term. So he said, when I am sowing an apple, when I am planting an apple tree, what has to come out of it is apple. An onion cannot come out of it. If an onion comes out of it, do you mean to say that even then you will presume that it is my child? Is how he has argued that case. So this is one more interesting judgment which I read. So what I want to say is that after the scientific advancement has happened, and today there is a possibility of having an accuracy of 99.999%. Why is it is completely closed when it comes to this conclusive proof? Okay, what is the reason why I am saying that it is completely closed? The reason why I am saying it is completely closed is that, please have a look at this judgment in Kamti Devi case. Kamti Devi case is reported in 2001, 5 SEC, page 311. 2001, 5 SEC, page 311. In that judgment, I would only want to read paragraph number 10. Paragraph number 10 was stunning. I had my own views on that. Para 10, I will read it. Please hear it carefully. Para 10, this is what Justice K.T. Thomas is saying. We may remember that Section 112 of the Evidence Act was enacted at a time when the modern scientific advancement with the DNA as well as RNA tests were not even in the contemplation of the legislature. So that is recognized. The result of genuine DNA test is said to be scientifically accurate. That's the finding. It's said to be scientifically accurate. But even that is not enough to escape from the conclusiveness of Section 112 of the Act. Example, the court gives an example. If a husband and wife were living together during the time of conception, the DNA test revealed that the child was not born to the husband, conclusiveness in law would remain irrebuttable. Look at this point. In spite of the test showing that this man is not the father, the proof as contemplated under Section 112 of the Evidence Act will remain irrebuttable. This may look hard from the point of view of the husband who would be compelled to bear the fatherhood of a child of which he may be innocent. But even in such a case, the law leans in favor of the innocent child from being bastardized if his mother and her spouse were living together during the time of conception. Hence, the question regarding the degree of proof of non-access for rebutting the conclusiveness must be answered in the light of what is meant by access or non-access as delineated above. Look at the extreme position that has been taken by the Honorable Supreme Court. Supreme Court says that, yes, sir, all that is there. Your test is saying that it is all never, that he is not the father. But it says that 112 is worded like this. So therefore, once there is a proof for access, throw away your DNA. Your DNA will not come to your rescue is the level to which it has been interpreted in this judgment in Kamti Devi. In Kamti Devi. Now, if this is what it is saying, I happened to lay my hands in a very, very, very interesting and very thought-provoking judgment of Justice Basant when he was the judge of the Kerala High Court sitting in a division bench. Please remember that Justice Basant was deciding this case in the year 2012 and he had a direct judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court which specifically says that where there is access, thereafter, don't try to rebut it with your DNA, etc., etc. test. So Justice Basant gets into all these issues. And Justice Basant without violating the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court, gives a very, very different meaning to this word access. That's the most interesting part. That's how the march of law has to happen. Justice Basant could not have avoided 112, the wordings used in 112. Justice Basant was bound by the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court. He could not have held otherwise, even if he had other opinions about it. But what he did was, he interpreted this word access in the modern context. So what he did was, when it comes to access, what is important, keeping in mind the present scientific development, is it has to be an access between the sperm and the ovum. Very interesting. He said that the access, that is the word access in 112, has to be understood in the present day context with scientific development to be an access of the sperm and ovum. The access of the sperm and ovum is something which can be found out by a DNA test. Therefore, he ordered for a DNA test. Very interesting. He did not violate what is there in 112. He did not directly go against the judgment of the Supreme Court, but he gave a very, very new dimension to this word access, as is found in section 112. My dear friends, today, in today's scenario, according to me, access must be given a more dynamic meaning. It must be given a more dynamic meaning, and we cannot continue to give it the same meaning as it was given in the year 1872, when there were absolutely no signs at all to prevent a childbirth. We must always have this in mind. So when the law was enacted, probably it had a meaning to it, taking into consideration the society that was prevailing then. Today we live in a very different society altogether. Today we live in an era where science is able to give you an exact approximate result with regard to this legitimacy of a child. So why not do it? So what happens is that after this judgment, there are two other judgments of the Honorable Supreme Court. One judgment is the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court in Nandalal case, 2014, 2 SEC, page 576. 2014, volume 2 SEC, page 576. And one more judgment to which I want to place reliance is the Deepan Vitta Roy judgment, which is 2015. One SEC criminal, 2015, page 683. If you look at these two judgments, the Supreme Court does not actually touch upon this word access there. It does not really deal with, does not really get into the issue of access. But Supreme Court merely says that here is a DNA which is available. Make use of the DNA to get proper access of the scientific development that is available today. In one of the cases, the parties themselves agreed for a DNA test. In the other case, it was a case of adultery, where the husband was complaining about adultery of the wife, and thereafter he was trying to say that this child would not have gone to me. But what is important is that in these two judgments, I do not find anything to show that the Supreme Court really went into this word access. Unless and otherwise, we are going to touch upon this word access and either give it a dynamic meaning or have a complete relook at section 112 itself. Today, the presumption is going to cause injustice to a person who otherwise clearly knows that he is not the father of a child. So when it comes to rendering of justice, it is also important to look at the individual rights of a person. A court has to render justice to the individual rights of a person. You don't give the man any opportunity to rebut it in spite of a scientific development available today. So therefore, I felt that there has to be a relook into it. In fact, the Law Commission has submitted the 185th report for recommending DNA, etc. But it has not been implemented. It has not been gone into. As on today, it stands as it is. My dear friends, before I end it up and give it to Mr. Justice Nagamuthu, one more thing about which you have to have in your mind is the surrogacy. See, surrogacy, in simple terms, means that one woman carries the child for another woman, and after the child is born, it is handed over to this woman. And this 112 and this child is considered to be the child of the parents for whom she has born it. So section 61 of this bill provides for determining the status of the child and etc. Today it is in the status of a bill. It has already been passed by the Lok Sabha. It has gone to the Rajya Sabha. Rajya Sabha committee was appointed. The committee has also submitted its report very recently in February 2020. So the reason why I roped in surrogacy was, today how do you understand 112? You understand 112 through access. What is access? Access is intercourse between a man and a woman. In a surrogacy, this never happens. There is no intercourse at all. In a surrogacy, what happens is that the sperm, the egg is placed in the womb of somebody, some other lady, and she delivers a child. In surrogacy, there is no question of sexual intercourse at all. It is all done through a scientific method. So therefore, when this comes into force, the provision under section 112 will require a complete relook, because even without an access, there is a possibility of a child being born to parents. So going back to what I said in the beginning, paternity also has an important aspect, an important role to play into it. Like how an adoptive father, the child that has been adopted is the legitimate child of those adoptive parents. The same way in surrogacy, the child for whom, the parents for whom the child is born by another lady and given to them, that child in law is the legitimate child of these parents. But the paternity there is again an issue. So therefore, it is a big area where there is scope for a lot of discussion. I would not want to really go in detail with regard to the surrogacy. I would want to end up by saying that it is high time that the legislature takes into consideration the present scientific development and either revamp the entire 112 or remove this word conclusive proof and bring it within the category of shall pursue, at least. If that is done, there is scope for the man to at least rebut the evidence that has already been placed before the court. So with these few words, I would request the retired Justice Nagamuthu to give his views. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much for an elaborate discussion. I do not know how I am going to sustain my view, because my view is slightly different.
Yes.
So before going to explain as to what are the issues involved in this matter in the light of the social interest, let me give one small case, which actually as a judge I did when I was sitting in the principal bench. That was a case of murder. A man was abducted, killed, and the body was thrown into a river in running water. The body could not be recovered at all. What could be recovered was a small amount of blood stains which were found somewhere near the place of occurrence, and one flesh from a place of occurrence, from some other place. They were done under Section 27 of the Evidence Act. Let us not go into that issue. Now the police officer who did the investigation wanted to prove that the blood was that of the person who was allegedly killed, and the flesh was that of the person who was allegedly killed. So in order to prove that, he wanted to go by the scientific examination, that is by DNA profile. He sent the son of the deceased and for the purpose of this DNA examination. To our shock, the report came that the blood and otherwise he was not the biological son of the one whose blood was found on whose flesh was found. Okay, therefore the prosecution could not prove that the man who was disappearing was actually killed, and the blood which was found and the flesh which was found were that of that man. The prosecution could not prove. Not stopping with that, the Inspector Police very cleverly now sent the daughter of the deceased for the purpose of examination. Now this time, DNA examination came in favor of the prosecution to say that she was the biological daughter of the person who was found missing, and thus they proved that the blood stains recovered and the flesh recovered were that of the person who was disappearing. Now there are two people. The deceased is no more. Now the wife may also not be available now. Let us assume the situation. Both her husband has been already killed. So wife is also not there, let us assume. Now there is a partition suit filed by the husband, by the son, against his sister. Sister takes up the plea that he was not born to my father, therefore he is not entitled for a share in the property. Now, if section 112 is not there, then he will not get anything, and the society will really call him as a bastard. Then he wants to know as to who is his father. Mother is certain, as it was rightly pointed out by Anand, mother is always sure. Father is not sure. One is told that he is the father. And before accepting so-and-so the father, the son or the daughter never demands for any scientific examination. He simply believes what is said to him or her by her mother or his mother, and as to how you are told by the society. These are the two yardsticks. In the given case, if DNA result used to be the conclusive evidence to prove the legitimacy, what will happen to the son? Please kindly think of that. Then as a result, what will happen in every case for partition or where there is a property dispute, everyone in a very casual manner will say that he was not born to my father. He was not born to my, she was not born to my father. Like that, a plea will be taken. In those cases, then DNA will be done in a routine fashion if 112 is not there. Because 112 is there, which prohibits any evidence being let in to disprove, then we are saved. So this is, in my view, is because of the fact that we are living in a society regulated mainly by the morality. This not we are administering law in court based on morality. There are certain morality which have been recognized by law. For example, polygamy has not been recognized. Monogamy has been recognized. That is the morality. This morality, which has got the recognition of the law, is implemented in courts. It is administered in courts. In my view, Section 112 only recognizes the societal morality that if a son or a child is born during this particular period of subsistence of marriage, it has to be presumed conclusively that the child was born only to them. This is what I feel. Now, in order to substantiate this, I will again go back to Section 4. There are three aspects in Section 4 that was very elaborately and succinctly put by Honorable Justice Anand. Number one is may presume. Number two is shall presume. Number three is conclusive proof. So conclusive proof itself is by means of presumption. So what is a presumption? Was dealt with by the Honorable Supreme Court in AIR 1962, page 1052. I do not want to read the judgment. I am only throwing it open for our participant to read the judgment. What do we mean by presumption? Presumption, as it was said by Honorable Justice Anand, is nothing but where it is found to be difficult to prove a particular fact, law permits the party to prove one fact by proving, suppose let us say that it is a fact. By proving a fact, the law permits the court or regulates the court to presume that the fact B is proved. So this is by proving one fact, by inference, by a guesswork, the other fact stands to be proved. So it is not in every case such presumption can be made. This presumption is again regulated by section 114 of the Evidence Act, which says it is may presume. Here, presumption used to be based on either one of the three aspects mentioned in section 114. 114, the first part says, based on the human conduct. Second part states, based on the natural events. Third part, business practice. So from out of these fundamental facts, when they are proved, the court has got, court is regulated to presume another fact. So one fact is proved by which the other fact is presumed. This is may presume. Why? There is any prudent man or reasonable man will presume the B fact. Assuming that section 114 is not there, let us go by section, the word proof, the may proved as it is said in section 3. What will happen? When a fact is proved, a fact is proved when the court believes its existence. That is, it is the belief of the court. Second part is not the belief of the court. It is by means of supposition. Whose supposition? It is a common man's, prudent man's supposition. That because a common man supposes, the court will not simply accept it. The court has to have one more examination, one more inquiry. What is that inquiry? The common man's supposition must be a probable one. Probable means most likely. There are two inquiries there. Number one, the court should put itself in the place of a common man, a prudent man, and suppose what would have happened. So secondly, the court has to see whether this supposition is probable. This is also an objective test by the court. If the court, after having put itself in the place of a prudent man, and also having come to the conclusion that it is probable, then only it holds that the fact is proved. Now coming to section 114, out of these three parts in section 3 that is proved, what is the part which we apply? It is the second part. Going by the human conduct, we put ourselves in the place of a prudent man and we say that fact B is proved. How? Both the tests are satisfied. Let me give a small illustration. I'm going to differentiate between this and section 112. Let me give an example, which very popularly I give always. Here is a husband and wife. They are sleeping on the terrace. Now the landlord is living in the down floor, in the ground floor. During night hour, there was some murmur, some unusual noise coming from the open terrace. They rush there. They find that the husband is fleeing away from the scene of occurrence. They go and see the deceased lying with injuries, just died with weapon, with a knife lying by the side. Now you put yourself in the common man's position. Who has committed the murder? It is the husband. Why? Our common man's understanding, common man's perception is that he would have only killed the deceased. That is why he was escaping. He was fleeing away from the scene of occurrence. Here, the court put its position, put itself in the position of a prudent man, a common man. How the court comes to this conclusion? It is mere supposition. What is supposition? The man flees away from the scene of occurrence. Therefore, I suppose that he alone would have killed. So based on this, that supposition, then court also goes to the next inquiry and see that it is the most probable one. Then the court holds that he has only killed. Now there are two aspects. What is a fact? A fact is that he was found fleeing away from the scene of occurrence. What is the B fact? Who killed? Whether he killed is a B fact. Now by proving A fact, we hold or we presume that B fact is proved. That is, by proving that this man was escaping from the scene of occurrence, which is unnatural conduct, we prove, we infer that B fact, that he only killed, is presumed. This is the magic that section 114 plays. So 114 only recognizes the what is otherwise supposed by a common man. So common man supposes, this supposition is recognized by section 114. Then again, you go to the term proof. Proof, the second part says, you put yourself in the position of a common man, prudent man. What is the supposition of a common man? That supposition should be the most probable one. Then it is proved. So keep this in mind. So may presume means this is what section 114 says. May presume, as stated in section 4, is that a fact may be, by proof of a fact, the court may presume the B fact. Now, wherever it is said that court may presume, there is a common man supposition that B fact is proved. Wherever, you just take any example. When you come to the case of shall presume, there need not be any such thing, interrelationship between fact A and fact B. The common man would not suppose that B fact is proved. Suppose you come to the case of 139 or section 118 of wherever it is stated that it shall presume. There need not be any interlink or there need not be a common man supposition that by proof of A fact that B fact shall stand proved. It is not by common man's supposition. It is by compulsion made by law. Okay? May presume means it is the common man's supposition, whereas if the law mandates that it shall presume, it need not be the common man's supposition. Even outside the purview of the common man's supposition, the lawmaker may incorporate a provision compelling the court to presume so. In that an event, we cannot ask for any reason. Why you are presuming like this? No, I cannot do anything. I have to presume. So law compels. When it is the question of may presume, one can question, why do you presume? Because you got discretion. Why do you presume? The court has to answer. I put myself in the position of a common man, a prudent man. My prudence says that B fact is proved because of the by the proof of A. In such an event, the court may presume. If the court says that no, from by proof of A, I cannot, a common man will not presume the B fact, then court may not presume. That is where the discretion lies so far as may presume is concerned. So there has to be a reasonable connection, link, nexus between A fact and B fact. That fact that is tested by a common man, a prudent man. So when the court examines whether may presume or not, the court has to put itself in the position of a prudent man and see whether by proof of A fact, B fact may be presumed. That is the discretion. That is why may presume. Okay? Now, come to shall presume. This inquiry is not available with the court at all. Whether a common man will presume the existence of B fact or proof of B fact by the proof of A fact. So, what is the link? So, there is one proverb. எங்க அடிச்ச எங்க பல்லு போச்சு அப்படின்னா யார் யார் ஒத்துக்குவான்னு சொல்லுவாங்க. அப்ப முதுகுல அடிக்கிறான், பல்லு விழுந்துருது, பல்லு போகுது. சொல்றான், என்னையா அது இங்க அடிச்சா இங்க எப்படியா பல்லு போகும்? பிகாஸ் ஏ காமன் மேன் டசன்ட் சப்போஸ் திஸ், பட் லா மே ஃபோர்ஸ் தி கோர்ட், கம்பல் தி கோர்ட் டு பிரிசியூம் திஸ். லா வில் சே முதுகுல அடிச்சா பல்லு விழும் அப்படின்னு பிரிசியூம் பண்ணு, ஷெல் பிரிசியூம் அப்படின்னா இந்த கோர்ட் நோ ஆப்ஷன். எப்போ முதுகுல அடிச்சிட்டே இல்லை, வெரி குட், பல்லு போயிச்சா பிரிசியூம், ஷெல் பிரிசியூம். This is therefore shall presume mean there is no further objective inquiry by the court by putting itself in the place of a common man, a prudent man. The court is not required to find the reasons as to why I am presuming. The court need not give any, find any reason for such a supposition. As a lawyer, when you talk of a case of may presume, you can question the court. You should not presume. What is the link? You put yourself in the position of a common man. You should not presume, we can say. But in the matter of shall presume, you do not have that inquiry at all. You cannot have that opportunity because law compels. If A is presumed, law compels him to presume that B fact is also proved. முதுகுல அடிச்சது ப்ரூவ் ஆயிடுச்சு இல்ல, முடிஞ்சு போச்சு. ஐ ஷெல் பிரிசியூம், பல்லு விழுந்தது நீ முதுகுல அடிச்சதுனால தான் ஐயா. So this is compulsion by law. So these two presumptions are, as it was said rightly and very aptly by Honorable Jason Arnold, are all rebuttable. Okay. In both these sections, if you look at, in the case of may presume, the final words of section 3, please come to, all of you kindly come to section 3, because I am giving you a very important thing. Apart from what is there, and this is very, very important for you. Come to section 4. Now, if you completely understand the concept of presumption under section 4, then there will be no difficulty in understanding section 112. And to accept my view rather than the view of Honorable Justice Anand. I leave it open for you to decide. No, I'm not. So again, I'm not compelling you to presume that I am right. Okay. Yes. We come to section 4 now. Yes. I have it now. Yes. See, whenever it is provided by this act that the court may presume a fact, it may either regard such fact as proved. Either regard that such fact proved unless and until it is disproved, or may call for proof of it. So the court may regard such fact as proved. The court may regard B fact as proved, provided it puts itself in the place of a prudent man and supposes that B fact is proved. If this is proved, if this court conduct this first test and come to the conclusion, yes, B fact is proved, I presume, then comes the question of disproving. That is what section says, unless and until it is disproved. If the court once raises the presumption using its discretion. Discretion is not arbitrary. I have told you that how the court has to presume and when and what under what circumstances. If the court so presumes, then it becomes the burden of the other adverse party to disprove it. That is what we call as rebuttal. The next part you will see is that R may call for proof of it, which means if the court declines to presume, because the court, having put a position in the position of a common man or prudent man, is not in a position to presume that B fact is proved. In such an event, the court will call upon the party to prove it by means of other evidence. I am not going to presume it. Okay, this. Now go to the next clause, shall presume. When one fact is declared by this act to be, whenever it is directed by this act, where you see the language used in the first clause, whenever it is provided by this act, so it is only regulatory. Now here, whenever it is directed by this act, so in the matter of shall presume, the court direct, the law directs the court, no inquiry, no further examination. The court directs, the law directs you to presume. Whenever it is directed by this court, that the court shall presume a fact, it shall regard such as proof. So the court will straightaway presume by the proof of a fact, the court shall presume, court will automatically presume. Court has got no option that B fact is proved. And if one such presumption is raised, and unless and until it is disproved, same language which you find in the first class. Same language, unless it is. What is missing here? The may call for proof of it. That is not, that is missing here. Why? Here you have to disprove the fact. The court has presumed. In part one, the court may refuse to presume and call for the party to prove. In this clause, the court has got no other option but to presume, shall presume, and therefore there is rebuttal. Now, in both these sections, unless and until it is disproved, is found the very same expression, same phrase, unless and until it is disproved. Now, whether there is any difference in the matter of disproof of these two, though the language is the same under both the classes, is there any difference in the matter of degree of proof so far as the party against whom this presumption is raised? Let us take the case of 114, may presume. One illustration says, whoever is found in possession of a stolen property soon after the theft, may be presumed the one who has committed the theft. So this is the presumption under section 114. Here, may presume until he disproves it. How to disprove? In order to discharge or rebut, it is enough for him to give an explanation. He need not lead any evidence to disprove at all. It is enough for him to give an explanation. Then an accused gives an explanation. Would it be enough? No. There is further inquiry to be held. That explanation should be reasonable. That is the only test. So far as may presume is concerned, the adverse party is not required to prove by means of any evidence or by any other method. It is enough for him to explain his position, but it is not sufficient. As far as the court is concerned, the court has to hold further inquiry to see whether this explanation is reasonable. Okay, so this is the proof that is required so far as this may presume is concerned. Now let us take the case of shall presume. In the case of shall presume, to say the there is an explanation is offered, that explanation is also found to be reasonable, would it be sufficient to hold that the presumption has been rebutted, or the fact presumed that the B fact has been disproved? No. Here, the degree of proof is something more. It is not a mere explanation. Here, it is by means of proof. In a case where it is said that the court shall presume, because the presumption is not on account of any examination by the court, by putting itself in the position of a prudent man, and it is out of compulsion. Now, on the assumption that legislature creates such a compulsion, not in every case, only in extraordinary and exceptional cases. Therefore, the law expects that the party has to disprove it, not only by means of mere explanation. So you take the case of the case under the prevention of corruption, or you take the case, let us not go to the prevention of corruption, you take the presumption under section 113A and 113B. Please, all of you come to 113A and 113B. See, I am coming to 112. Mr. Anand, kindly bear with me.
No.
Yeah, I come to 112. Then only yes. I can justify.
Yes.
So you take these two examples. 113A. Here, court may presume. 113B shall presume. So what is 113A? In a case of suicide by a married woman, the court may presume. Okay. In this case, under section 306, whenever a person is prosecuted, because the word may presume is used, it is enough to offer explanation under section 313 CRPC.
Yes.
But the further inquiry, as I said, was that the court has to see whether that explanation is reasonable or not. The court cannot find fault with the accused that he has not let in any evidence. The court cannot find fault with any further anything with the accused that he has not done this, that, or that. That he cannot do. But coming to section 114B, it shall presume. When you are doing a case under section 304B, and where the presumption under section 113B is there, please keep in your mind that mere explanation under section 313 will not serve your purpose. You have to lead some more evidence. You have to lead some more evidence. You have to prove it, disprove it virtually. How you will do that? I am going to cite the judgments for you. I do not want to read all those judgments now. I just give those judgments later. How you are going to do? So, the presumption under section 113B is out of compulsion. This is shall presume. But at the same time, it allows a rebuttal. The rebuttal may be either by means of direct evidence, or by means of circumstantial evidence, or again by means of presumption. What is the confusion? What is the confusion? 113B itself speaks of presumption. I say that you can have another presumption against it. How is it? It is very simple. That is why these two presumptions have been broadly classified in different languages. The Supreme Court says that the presumption may presume is a presumption of fact, whereas this presumption shall presume is presumption of law.
Law.
Yes. You please kindly see this difference. That is presumption of fact. This is presumption of law. A fact can be explained, but a law cannot be explained. Law, the presumption arising out of law used to be disproved. This is the distinction. How you can do now? The disproof can be by means of direct evidence. You can put witnesses in the box and rebut the presumption. Again, the presumption, you can give evidence. Okay, this is one way. The other way is you can during cross-examination of the witnesses put by the prosecution or by the plaintiff, or maybe you can brought on record the circumstances which will give rise to the presumption. Again, now you go to section 3, proved or disproved. We have to disprove. What is disprove? Having considered the matter before the court, when the court believes, or the same test, supposition of a common man. This is a presumption of fact. As I already told you, the presumption under section 114 is a presumption of fact, whereas under section 113B, it is a presumption of law. So when once presumption of law is made under section 113B, then the burden shifts on the accused. Now the accused may disprove or rebut it by another presumption. That presumption is presumption of law, not fact. How you will apply section 114? That presumption. So by means of this presumption, you can dislodge the legal presumption of law raised under the clause shall presume. I'll give one small illustration. You come to section 118 of the Negotiable Instruments Act.
Presumption as to negotiable instruments.
Yes,
until please. The contrary is proved, the following presumptions shall be made.
Yeah, shall be
A, made. Of consideration.
Okay.
That every negotiable instrument was drawn, was made or drawn for consideration. Such instrument. Yes.
Enough. So here it is shall presume. Okay.
Yes.
The court shall presume. What is the A factor here? The negotiation instrument was drawn. Let us go to the case of a check.
Yes.
A check is executed and is given. Okay.
Yes.
So A factor is proved. What is the presumption? It is shall presume that it was drawn for consideration.
Consideration.
Okay. So is there any nexus between these two? Whether a common man would simply believe that? No. Common man will not believe that always that the check was issued for money. Therefore, law compels the court to presume, shall presume that it was drawn for consideration. Okay. This is compulsion. This is the presumption of law. Now, this presumption raised by law can be dislodged by presumption of a fact. See, I will give small illustration. 114 says that if the best evidence available is dispensed with, 114G, illustration G. If the best evidence available is dispensed with, is barked by the party, then there shall be an adverse presumption against him. Is it not? So in this case, suppose the defendant takes the plea that it was not drawn for consideration. Pro note or check was not drawn for consideration. He takes the plea. Now, but the court, because of section 118, presumes, yes, it was drawn for consideration. It was drawn for money, etc. Now, the defendant having taken the plea, he issues notice to the other party to produce his account books. He refuses to produce. He wants him to produce the income tax statement. He refuses to produce. Whereas during cross-examination, he admits, yes, I have made entry. I took out this money from my business. And everything is accounted in the account book. He admits that. Now you come to section 114. What is the business practice? Every entry is made in the account book. So there is a presumption that it is entered there. When he suppresses that, there is a presumption of fact. There is a presumption of fact, not law. Under 114, what is the presumption of fact? The best evidence he has suppressed. Therefore, he would not have paid the money. That is a presumption. This presumption, here there are two facts. A fact is that it is there in the account book, which he has suppressed. What is the B fact that he presumed now? B fact presumed is, a common man will presume this. Any common man, if it is there, already produce it. The very fact that you are not producing it goes without saying that you do not have that. So this is a common man presumption. This is presumption of fact. So by proving this fact, which is by means of presumption of fact, which is permissible under section 118, we will rebut the presumption under section 118 of the NIA. You please kindly see this. So the difference between these two, it is very, very simple. So if you understand the difference between presumption of law and presumption of fact, then you will know as to what is the degree of standard that is required to disprove. So this is in respect of disproof. Okay, then let us go to the next stage. Now, having understood these two provisions, let us now move on to the term conclusive proof. Conclusive proof has got two things. Conclusive proof may be out of it may be presumption of law or presumption of fact, but because there is a compulsion to presume, it is always taken as a presumption of law. Okay, I think there is no difference between shall presume and this presumption under which is say that it is conclusive proof. This here again there is a compulsion, so this presumption is also a compulsion, there is also a presumption of law. It may be true that for a common man also, the same supposition may be arrived at, but there is no discretion given to the court. Therefore, we call this presumption also as a presumption of law only. Okay. So let us go now to section 112. Before that, this we'll read this clause. Conclusive proof. When one fact is declared by this act to be conclusive, please kindly see the difference in language. First one, I brought your notice, whenever it is provided by this act, that he may presume. Second, shall presume, whenever it is directed by this court. Here, whenever it is declared by this act. So it declares more than a mere compulsion. Okay, it does not allow the court to presume at all. It does not burden the court to presume. Please kindly understand. Though in common parlance we say that this by itself is a presumption, there are, when you compare the language used in all these three provisions, we will very easily understand. So far, first one is concerned, a discretion is given. So far, the second is concerned, there is a compulsion to the court to presume. But when you come here, there is no compulsion at all to anybody. There is no discretion, admittedly. There is no compulsion also. Here, it declares. So there is no inquiry by the court at all. When there is no inquiry at all by the court, when one fact is declared by this act to be conclusive proof of another, when one fact is declared to be the conclusive proof of another fact, it shall regard, the court shall, on proof of the fact, regard the other as proved, and shall not allow the party to evidence to be given for the purpose of disproving it. Therefore, two things we will see. In the case of may presume, the adverse party may disprove. How to disprove? By mere explanation, that is enough, reasonable explanation. When you come to shall prove, there is a higher degree of disproof. How? By means of evidence, direct, by means of circumstantial evidence, or by means of presumption of law, of fact, these things. But here, when you come to the case of conclusive proof, there is no question of court being forced to presume. Law says you have to simply adopt. The law declares there is no presumption. If it is a simple presumption, as stated in the other two clauses, question of disproof will come. Here it is not presumption. This is a substantive law. this is not a, in my perception, this is not a mere procedural law relating to evidence. Yeah, this is a substantive law which declares that one fact is proved by the other. But the Honorable Supreme Court has taken a different view. Now, in one case, so I will go to those cases later, I think. In one case, what happened? That was a case under the Passport Act. Under the Passport Act, there is a clause which says that if an Indian citizen acquires the citizenship of some other country between 1950 to 1955, then it shall be presumed that he is not an Indian citizen. Okay. Now, there is another clause which says if an Indian obtains the passport of another country during this period, then it will be conclusive proof that he has ceased to be an Indian citizen. So conclusive proof. One person gets the passport of Pakistan in the year 1954. He gets the passport of Pakistan. Now what is the presumption? Presumption is that there you apply the position of common man. No presumption can be raised whether he is seized or not. Nothing is there. But the law compels that it shall be the conclusive proof that he has ceased to be an Indian citizen. When this came up before the Honorable Supreme Court, whether any rebuttal evidence can be let in, the court said no, because it is conclusive proof. Referring to this provision, the Supreme Court, a constitution bench, said no, nothing doing, because you have obtained the passport, and when you obtained the passport of Pakistan, you would have declared there that you are a Pakistan citizen. Otherwise, Pakistan government would not have given you a passport, which gives rise to this conclusive proof that you ceased to be an Indian citizen, though you were an Indian citizen originally. Now, between 1950, after the coming into force of the Constitution, and until the date of declaration, coming into force of the Passport Act, if you have obtained the passport of Pakistan or any other country, it shall be the conclusive proof that you have ceased to be an Indian citizen. While interpreting, when this provision was challenged, the question was whether the term conclusive proof as mandated in law is again a presumption of law, presumption of fact, whether it is rule of evidence or substantive law. The Supreme Court has categorically held, by referring to various judgments of Privy Council, Canada, Singapore, so many other Supreme Court, has finally held that what is stated in Section 4 as conclusive proof is also a rule of evidence. It is not substantive law. That is the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court. I will give you all the judgments. Now, keep this in mind. Section 4 does not permit the other party to leave any evidence. This part alone, we are concerned with section, shall not allow evidence to be given for the purpose of disproving it. So what is to be disproved? A fact is the law declares that by proof of A fact, B fact stands proved. Then the B fact has not been proved. You cannot lead any evidence to disprove it. This is what is the bar contained here. Please kindly closely watch it. It will be very, very useful for you in several cases when you are dealing with these negotiable instruments case also more particularly. Now let us go to section 112. What it is all about? The fact that any person during the continuance of a valid marriage between his mother and man or within 200 days, etc., etc., shall be conclusive proof that he is the legitimate son of that man. So you cannot lead any evidence that he is not the legitimate son. So law declares it. It is not a presumption. So presumption stops with mere presume and shall presume, where you are allowed to rebut. If it is a mere presumption, then very well you can rebut it. This is not a presumption, it is a declaration. made by the law. This is a declaration. Therefore, the lawmaker very, very aptly used the word whenever it is so declared by this act. It is a declaration by law. Presumption means there is an inquiry by the court and there is something done by the court by using its mental faculty, by using its judicial conscience. The court may presume or shall presume. There is a question of presumption. But though in common parlance we call this conclusive proof as a presumption, in fact, a close scrutiny would go to show that it is not a presumption. It is a declaration made by law, and therefore you are not allowed to rebut it, to disprove it. Unless it can be shown that the parties to the marriage had no access to each other at any time when he could have been begotten. So non-access, what is the time at which non-access can be proved? More or less at the time when he would have been conceived. Okay, that is what 280 days something we say. Why this law was made by the lawmaker? Please understand that. Why this was made? No, in every case otherwise, this society, that is why I said that there are two things. One, when the child is born during the subsistence of the marriage, any common man, any prudent man will also say that the child was born to this man. So even for a common man, a prudent man, as stated in section 3, the court will presume, the court shall hold that this fact is proved. Let us forget about 112. 112 is not there. Marriage is there. They are living together. Child is born. What a common man, a neighbor will say, the child was born to this man. Is it probable? Yes, it is probable. The boy was born to him is now proved as per section 3 or not? Yes, proved. Leave alone section 112. Even in the absence of section 112, by applying the yardstick in section 3, we can say that the child was born to him. I want to repeat it again. How? When a fact is proved, a fact is proved when the court believes it, or reducing itself or positioning itself to the position of a prudent man, when it supposes, and when that supposition is probable. These are the two inquiries. These are the two exam tests, examinations. Now, forget 112. Living together, child is born during the marriage. What is the supposition? Supposition of a common man for the purpose of section 3 is child was born to him. Now, apart from that, is it probable? Yes, it is probable. Therefore, as per section 3, it can be proved that the child was born only to this man. Okay? This is possible. Now, when the law now declares, because this presumption, because this proof, some courts may err in it, while positioning itself in the common man position, etc., court may err. Because the lawmaker did not want to leave any choice to the court. That is why they said, the law declared that it is conclusive proof. Don't allow any rebuttal evidence. This was done in the larger interest of the society. As I told, we are living in a society which is guided by a lot of moral things. Morality. A society without a morality is not a society, and the living of the people will amount to animal existence. This is what I sincerely feel. A man, why there is marriage institution? Why should there be marriage? Anybody can take any woman. Any woman can take a man, have sex, beget a child. Why should there be marriage? This, from time immemorial, we have been keeping it as a moral. Yes, you marry one person, you take him, you take her as your wife, or take him as your husband. They're nothing but morality. This morality, we have been practicing for thousands of years. We find clue for this evidence for this, even in Thirukkural. Piranmanai Vidayamai. It is there in Thirukkural. 2000 years ago, we had this morality in the country and in our society. This morality is recognized by law. Therefore, the courts of law are not simply administering law, the justice, on the basis of morality. When a morality takes the shape of a law, an enactment, court implements. Therefore, I would say that Section 112 speaks of morality and it is a public policy which is for the benefit of the society. Now, let us move on further. If this is changed, what will happen? Honorable Justice Anand, he is supported by the Law Commission report. We say that 112 should be changed because in tune with the latest scientific developments. And it is also said that because science is growing, information technology is growing, developing all along, the law should also find a change. Because of this scientific development, are we going to say that the morality of the society or the public policy of the society should be changed? Are we going to say that? Whatever be the scientific advancement or development, that should not destroy the social fabric, the morality of the society. So what is the moral, what is the morality that Section 112 preserves the institution of marriage and the legitimacy of the children born out of the marriage? Because science has developed, we cannot destroy it. This is my humble view. Now coming to these cases. Now, Honorable Justice was referring to the judgment of Justice Basant. I fully agree with the said judgment. If you agree with the judgment, then Section 112 need not undergo any change at all. Now, what is permitted under Section 112? Law declares that he is a legitimate son. No evidence can be let in disproof. But it has not closed the defense. It opens a defense. What is the defense available? You can prove non-excess. How to prove non-excess? Non-excess means, see, it is understandable. Non-excess does not mean both are going and coming together or traveling together. Access here means sexual access. Sexual access. That is the meaning that we have to give. So, this is interrelated to the child, legitimacy of the child. So, the access should have a close, proximate relationship with the child. When a child is born, when there is fertilization of ovum and the egg and the sperm, there is fertilization. So, as it was rightly said, that access here means that there is access for fertilization. It may be physical. Now, we know that science is so developed that the sperm from a person is extracted from his semen and it is preserved in the lab for years together. So these people who are doing these fertility centers, they keep it. They develop, see, suppose the husband does not have sufficient number of counts. They extract semen from him and pick out some sperms which are very active, preserve it for months together, years together, I will say. They preserve it. Now, when the wife's body condition becomes all right after treatment to bear the child, what they do, they fertilize it outside. Fertilization does not take place inside. No, it is fertilized outside. It is kept inserted into the abdomen. There it is kept. It develops in the womb of the mother. Child comes up. Now there was no physical access between these two. There was no physical access. There was no sexual contact between these two. Can we say that there was no access? So for the purpose of this provision, there is access. The husband cannot take a view that I was all along in Singapore. Suppose in this case, he says, during the year 2010, when the child was born, in the month of December. I never visited India. I was in Singapore. He takes a plea. I was not here. So he proves non-access, physical non-access. Are we going to say that the child was not born to him? Till it is open for the wife to prove that the child was born to him by two methods. How? There has to be a pleading made by her to say that sperm from this man was extracted when he was in India, and the sperm, the active sperm, were extracted and they were kept free in a freezer, in a scientific lab. And after my body condition became all right, it was fertilization was done outside, it was inserted. So here, though there is no physical contact, though fertilization did not take place inside, though fertilization has not taken place inside, still it is proved that there was access. So I go one step further than what has been said by Justice Basant. Therefore, the access here means, rightly as said by Honorable Justice Anand, access of the sperm and the womb, no doubt about it. So to this extent, you can allow evidence. Now you go to DNA. Now, in order to prove this non-access, you want to go for DNA. Now I will say, if for that purpose, section 112 need not be changed. In all these judgments, this Gautam Guntu 1993, Gandhi Devi, then Nantral, in all these cases, Supreme Court has made it very, very clear. What does it say? All right. If you want to prove non-access, very well, you can approach the court for DNA exam. But the court should not do it in a routine fashion. The court has not rejected the scientific development. Court has accepted. Court says, but kindly don't do in every case, because it will have a lot of impact on the child. Kindly don't do that in a routine fashion. This is what he said by the Supreme Court. Then why should there be change in section 112? Non-access can be proved by means of evidence that I was in a foreign country, you can put his passport and all that. When the wife says, no, there was access of his sperm with my ovum, not in my body, outside, if there is sufficient pleading, then access is proved. Now, in order to prove that access, the wife can very well go for DNA examination. You please kindly understand this. Husband cannot go for inches for DNA in a routine fashion, but the wife can certainly ask for. Why? She is sure that the child is born to this man only. She wants to prove that. So section 112 does not allow disproof. It allows further proof. So the wife can very well make. You may know the case of N.D. Tiwari, and he had a woman and a son. There in that case, the son filed the petition. Therefore, the Supreme Court said that 112 is not a bar for the son to prove the access between this man and his mother and the child born. In that case, because there was no marriage, and he had to go for DNA to prove the legitimacy itself, that he was born to that man. So please kindly understand this difference. So therefore, in my view, it is not at all required that section 112 is to be changed. If it is changed, it will surely destroy the social fabric. What will happen? In every case, simply out of some anger. For example, in every case of partition, in future, plea will be taken. He was not born to my father. He is a bastard. Then, even such a plea is taken, court will also, if this amendment is allowed, court will allow, yes, all right, go for examination, DNA. DNA examination will come against him. So, can we say, unless we are sure that every woman in this country or every man in this country follows the path of chastity, then we cannot change the law. lawmakers knew very well that in the society here and there there will be some aberration in the women or in the case of men. Both are equally guilty. Having taken note of this aberration in the society, but at the same time, in order to preserve the fabric of the society, the fabric of the institution of marriage and the inheritance and all the other civil consequences, the law under section 112 was made, which in my considered view does not require any change at all. This has to go. Otherwise, every man's, I want to close by saying that every man's paternity will be doubted. Honorable Justice Anand tried to distinguish between the paternity and legitimacy. No, legitimacy in this section should not be allowed to receive the same meaning as it is found in section 16 of the Hindu Marriage Act or in the Hindu Succession Act. Their legitimacy is a different concept, but here legitimacy means it is, in my view, more or less paternity. They are interlinked, they are interrelated. One cannot survive without the other. For the purpose of section 112, I say they are not two independent things. Both will go hand in hand and both will survive together. One will not survive independently of the other. Therefore, let us not confuse between paternity and the legitimacy. Legitimacy for the purpose of inheritance and all that, which has dealt with in Hindu Marriage Act, Hindu Section Act, are different concepts. For the purpose of section 112, here the purpose is to allow the child not being branded as a bastard in future for the no sin committed by the child. So as it was rightly held by Honorable Justice K.T. Thomas, it will be hard to say or to direct the person to bear fatherhood for a child who was not born to him. Maybe, but he has to bear with that. He has to bear with that, because for the sake of the very survival of the society and for the sake of the interest of the child. So that view, in my humble opinion, is a correct view. Now I conclude. I would give some judgments which you may kindly take note of. The earliest judgment is Vaidyanatha Iyer case, State of Madras versus Vaidyanatha Iyer. I am very proud to say that all important cases which laid down the law by the Supreme Court had emanated from the Madras High Court. Our lawyers, and we belong to that family, we are all their offsprings. So they were great people. You see, this case was argued in Chennai. One plea was taken that was upheld by the Supreme Court. Yeah, several judgments for that matter, we can say, right from A.K. Gopalan. See, AIR 1958 Supreme Court, page 61, State of Madras versus Vaidyanatha Iyer. Here, they have very elaborately held as to what is may presume and shall presume, what is the, in the matter of presumption of law, what is presumption of law and what is presumption of fact. May presume is a presumption of fact. Shall presume is a presumption of law, because law compels with no inquiry. Okay, so they have held in this case. Then this was later on was further developed or clarified in Dhanvantharai, AIR 1964 Supreme Court, page 575. So Vaidyanatha Iyer only said that may presume is a presumption of fact. The other one, shall presume, is a presumption of law. Then in this judgment, they categorically said in the case of may presume, then what is required is may presume, mere explanation. For the other one, it is proof, disproof, something more than this. For that, you can cite this judgment. And another judgment I would cite, paragraph 6 and 7, in AIR 1961 Supreme Court, page 1316, Gundan law versus custodian. If you read the judgment, what is the concept of presumption has been very elaborately dealt with by this case. This is a case under section 138 of NIA Act. Here you will find that the presumption of law, which is shall presume, can be rebutted by a presumption of fact. Wonderful, wonderful judgment. Presumption of law, which is shall presume, a fact which is presumed by means of this shall presume, can be rebutted by presumption of fact. Wonderful judgment. Read the judgment also, 1961. Then 1964, these three judgments. This 1964, paragraph 12. The burden resting on the accused person in such a case would not be a light, as it is where prosecution is presumption is raised under section 114. Now, apart from that, the other judgments my Honorable Justice Bang has given about another judgment is AIR 1962 Supreme Court, page 1052. This is as what is a presumption. Please kindly read these judgments. This will give you a clear understanding. Therefore, in conclusion, I say that section 112 does not require any modification or any change. With this, I conclude. Thank you very much. Now, Mr. Srinivas Raghavan, may comments.
My perspective is a totally different plan from stating that I'm going to reflect the predicament of practicing advocates before the courts and the judges of the Noyer judiciary, because both of us are caught between the deep sea and the devil. Devil in the sense that the unamended evidence side, section 112, and deep sea means the volume of judgments which are contradictory to each other. First of all, let me just go to a situation where trial is going on, taking place in a suit for, in a petition for divorce, for example, on the issue of husband suspecting the paternity of the child. As SNJ has rightly put it out, section 112 is only a substantive piece of law. It is not the procedural law, and we are going to invoke either section 75E or order 26 rule 10A or section 45 for the purpose of filing an application to call for an expert opinion in the nature of a DNA test result. The question is, when does the petitioner who alleges that the child is not born to him is to be adduced in such a proceeding? As the section is very clear, between the two facts, one fact is declared to be proved, that the court is bound to take the other fact is conclusively proved, so that there is no question of inviting any contrary evidence. Section 4 is strict in the sense that once section 112 is invoked and the court comes to the conclusion that the child was born during the continuance of the valid marriage, there is no other option open to the court than to come to the conclusion proof, provided there is no proof of non-access by the petitioner who asserts that the child was not born to him. So now we are supposed to stand in a position where the evidence is taking place before the judgment is passed. The court can come to the conclusive proof only at the time of final disposal of the proceedings, not during the evidence is going on. So now my predicament is, assuming that the wife, as SNJ has correctly pointed out, is able to plead and prove that there was access between her and the husband. Now it is for the petitioner in the IA or the husband who asserts that the child was not born to him to adduce proof of non-access. That is the only way to dispel or rebut the presumption that is raised before the court has come to the conclusive proof. It is what I understanding of section 112 is. This is where the problem comes in. The first reason I find that section 112 requires an amendment is because of the employment of the word valid marriage in section 112. As you may found out, section 112 speaks of conclusive proof of legitimacy, and it does not speak of paternity, to be frank with you. The section reads as follows. The fact that any person was born during the continuance of a valid marriage between his mother and any man the world is not husband, or within 280 days after its dissolution, the mother remaining unmarried shall be conclusive proof that he is the legitimate son of that man, unless it can be shown that the parties to the marriage had no access to each other at any time when he could have been begotten. The word begotten can be conceived to be conceived rather. Now the question is, what kind of mode of evidence the court contemplates for the petitioner to give proof of non-access? Before that, I kindly want all of us to ponder over for a moment the word valid marriage. The word valid marriage might have been very much of significance in 1872, or at least till recently in 1980. Now, because of the decriminalization of Section 490, adultery law is now decriminalized, and live-in is being commonly prevalent. Conception between a man and woman is possible without there being a valid marriage. And we have got a presumption of parentage because of even absence of a valid marriage. The question is whether the word valid marriage is to be contained in Section 112 even now is a big question mark. Because I want to draw the attention of all the viewers, Section 16 of the Hindu Marriage Act, where there is a presumption that even children born out of void or voidable marriage are presumed to be legitimate children for the purpose of Hindus only. I don't find any parallel presumption available for any other religion except the Hindus. So the word valid marriage will cause a hindrance in the future whenever there is a dispute arises out of the dispute of legitimacy when there was no valid marriage at all. This being the first point I want to buttress. Second point is that once the court comes to the conclusion that there is no effective evidence by the petitioner or the husband to prove non-access, the court is bound to come to the conclusive proof, which under Section 4 does not allow any contrary evidence. So the question is, what kind of evidence the husband can adduce or the petitioner can adduce to prove that the child was not born to him? As SNJ has rightly pointed out, there are cases in which not necessarily husband suspects the child to be born to him. There are cases like Rohit Shagar versus N.D. Tiwari, and recently Justice P.T. Asha has made a judgment in Yeti Raju's case where the son has filed a suit for declaration of fatherhood against the father. In which cases also, these questions are relevant. So my little understanding of section is that before the court comes to the conclusive proof at the end of the trial, the petitioner who asserts that the child was not born to him, or the petitioner, or even the man who asserts that there was a chance for a conception or what is called access, all that has got to give proof of either non-access or access. So it is in this stage, I find that the law remains a little bit elusive in the present day context. The reason being, now, because of the advancement of science and technology, what I called ART, Artificial Reproductive Technology, even without access, as SNJ has rightly put it out, even without access, there can be conception. For example, we have got IVF technology, we have got IUI technology, we have got sperm donation being permissible by the law. In such cases, access or non-access cannot be the only mode of proof in the present day circumstances, in my humble opinion. Because in the case SNJ has cited, the husband was in Singapore. He has got his sperm donated, which was kept safe in the sperm bank. And if the wife is able to prove that same sperm donated by the husband was injected to her and she conceived, the question of access becomes totally irrelevant. So this kind of stalemate is still possible because of scientific technology, even without touching the spouse, even without having actual sexual intercourse, conception is now possible. So in my humble opinion, we are in a confused stage because of the change of circumstances in the modern world. I appreciate if women and men or following the virtue which has been what is called propagated by our elders, Piranmalai Nokkaamai, Piranmani Vilayaamai, everything is being prevalent. Absolutely, there is no scope for any dispute. Now, gone are the days. And if I am not mistaken, multiple access by a woman with more men in a single day is possible today. If that be the case, even the woman may not be able to know who exactly is the father of the child. That is the present day. The law exists in the statute book, the law has got some discrepancy in the way in which the suits are for partition, or suit for declaration of status, or suit for succession certificate, or section 125 CRPC cases, or suit for partition, or matrimonial disputes are filed, where incidentally this question will be the sheer dint of the proof of the real crux of the issue. So now my next endeavor is to find that what is the march of law in this matter. First case governing the field was Gautam Kuntu versus State of West Bengal in the year 1993. It is reported in 1993, Volume 3, Supreme Court Cases, page 418. Here, this judgment, I would say rather, is a compendium of very important fact that what was the march of law in England and how the Indian parliamentarians failed to keep pace with the scientific development. It is not the Indian parliamentarians, even the British Parliament, which was enacting law for India till 1947, did not care to amend the Indian Evidence Act, because I would rather amazed to find that English law has been periodically amended. And I would find that the judgment of Gautam Kuntu speaks of amendments by the British Parliament for the laws applicable in England, thereby paving way for making blood test as one of the tests to decide the issue of legitimacy and paternity. I would rely upon paragraphs number 8 to paragraph number 15 of the judgment of Supreme Court in Gautam Kuntu's case, where the Supreme Court has dealt with at length the law prevailing in England, the law prevailing in Canada, and the law prevailing in US even before our pre-independent stage. In fact, the judgment goes off with citing the acts even. In 1957, the British Parliament enacted Affiliation Proceedings Act. Under that act, it was assumed that a man was father once a sexual relationship with the mother at the time of conception was proven, unless he could show another man had had intercourse with her at that time. Failing the father's attempt, the mother's evidence had to be corroborated by facts such as blood tests, etc. Again, Family Reforms Act 1969 conferred powers on the court in England to take blood tests in civil proceedings where paternity is in issue. Once again, Lord Denning, the one of the finest judges the world has ever seen, has spoken of this in two cases. Number one, 1968, two All England reports, page 1023. 1968, two All England reports, page 1023, where Lord Denning would say the country court judge, who are equal to our Mofassil judges, will refer to a high court judge as a matter suitable for ancillary relief, and the high court judge can order the blood test. Likewise, of course, the magistrate's court has no power to order a blood test against the will of the parties. The magistrate can only do it by consent of those concerned, namely the grown-ups and the mother on behalf of the child. But nevertheless, if any one of them does not consent, the magistrate can take that refusal into account. I adhere to the view which I expressed, he himself expressed in L. Re. case. If an adult unreasonably refuses to have a blood test or to allow a child to have one, I think it is open to the court in any civil proceedings to take his refusal as evidence against him and may draw adverse inference from that to him. Thereafter, the law has been keeping on being amended, and the Supreme Court has cited Forensic Sciences book edited by Cyril H. in para 14 to say how bloodless was in vogue in German, in England, and in New York Supreme Court, wherein the paternity was being questioned by people. But that being the case, I am at loss to understand why British Parliament was not bothered to amend the Indian law correspondingly. The next question is the judgment of Supreme Court in Sharda versus Dharampad. In fact, this is a landmark case that rules the field because it is delivered by a 3-judge bench of Supreme Court. Sharda versus Dharampad, 2003, volume 2, CTC, page 760. This is a case where a matrimonial dispute was filed by the husband against the wife, alleging that she was suffering from schizophrenia and a mental disorder. And he has filed an application thereby requesting the court to direct the wife to undergo a medical examination. An interesting phenomena arises here where the wife would buttress Article 21 of the Constitution of India as a defense to state that I cannot be compelled to undergo the examination because it violates Article 21, my personal liberty. The Supreme Court has dealt with the issue at length, and the judgment has got 3 important aspects. Number one, in page 776, the Supreme Court has given an answer whether Article 21 can be pitted against such a petition and can be defended by the respondent, stating that in case of any direction to undergo such a blood sample or DNA sample, whether it would violate Article 21, the Supreme Court says no. The reason given by the Supreme Court is very simple. By citing lot of judgments and by citing lot of provisions, other provisions in the law, the Supreme Court says that Article 21 is subject to a limitation or restriction, that a personal liberty can be restricted in the procedure known to law, where the court says the procedure known to law under Section 112 of the Evidence Act is nothing but discharge of burden of proof by the husband. So what is thought to be done by a petitioner by seeking a medical evidence, either by DNA test or any other test, is only in the exercise of burden of discharge of burden of proof. So that can be an exception to the right under Article 21. So any attempt by any of the petitioner to seek a recourse under any of the provisions of the Act, thereby requesting the court to permit him to discharge the burden of proof, cannot be a violation of Article 21, is the reason given by the larger bench of Supreme Court in Sharda's case. In the same judgment, the Supreme Court has elaborately discussed, I would just pinpoint the page number 776 and 777. The Supreme Court painstakingly has discussed various other provisions of other acts where such a procedure are allowed by the statute. For example, the Supreme Court referred to Section 185, 202 and 204 of the Motor Vehicles Act, and the Section 53 and 54 of the CRPC, and Section 3 of the Identification of Prisoners Act, wherein there are provisions compelling the persons to be a subject matter of taking samples or something which will not violate Article 21. Then again, the case in AR 2001, Andhra Pradesh, page 502, between M. Vijaya versus the chairman, Singareni Collieries. AR 2001, Andhra Pradesh, 502, in a case between M. Vijaya versus the chairman, Singareni Collieries and others, the court has compared a provision wherein the government is authorized to what is called, as we are in the corona period, suspected HIV patients to subject themselves for a test so that such persons are identified, they are kept in quarantine or they are treated. So we can take a parallel example of COVID patient. If a COVID patient start to invoke Article 21, I should not be compelled to undergo test, you know what will happen. So the Supreme Court has rightly held that Article 21 cannot be pitted as a defense to say that my personal liberty is infringed. Now, before concluding my remarks, I want to speak on 3 aspects where the law needs some revisit or revamping, or we need a separate law for this purpose. in such a proceeding, we have got three stages wherein the question is considered. Number one, whether a petition for a DNA test or a scientific test can be granted for mere asking, number one. Number two, in case when a petition is so ordered, what is the course open to the respondent against whom such an order is passed? Number three is very, very crucial, where I stand perplexed. The third situation is where there is a chance for the wife to prove access, and there is no direct proof by the husband as to non-access. But the access theory, if followed, would compel the court to come to a conclusive proof that the child was born to the petitioner. Whereas the test result of the scientific test is in the nature of stating that the petitioner is not the biological father of the child. So the third situation is this. In case of conflict of what is called a conclusion between the evidence available on record and the conclusive proof and the scientific result, which among the two will prevail? This is the situation I want to contemplate. Regarding the first issue, namely whether the petitioner can be allowed to go with an order of a scientific test for mere asking, invariably all the courts say that it is not so. There must be a prima facie case. The Supreme Court has not used the word prima facie evidence. There must be a prima facie case to find that there is a chance for the husband or the petitioner to prove something against the evidence available on record by the wife or the respondent. So the court says a petition for a scientific test can be allowed, but without there being a roving inquiry and with in the presence of a prima facie case. This is the first thing. Second question is, supposing such an application is allowed by the court, for some reason the wife or the respondent is not cooperating with the court, she refuses to undergo the process of giving blood sample, what is to be done? Most of the courts, including the Supreme Court in Sharda versus Dharampal and Nandlal Baitwak and Deepanpita, they request a court to draw a presumption, I mean adverse inference under section 114. As all you would know, section 114 has got illustration. Illustration H is relevant. Section 114 illustration H says that if a man refuses to answer a question which he is not compelled to answer by law, the answer if given would be unfavorable to him, is a chance where the court may draw adverse inference. So the Supreme Court has been holding that in case of refusal by the respondent to undergo the test and to give samples, the court has got every power to draw adverse inference. Here, I find an interesting judgment of what is called the Supreme Court in the case of N.D. Tiwari. N.D. Tiwari's son, Mr. Rohit Sheher, has gone to the court claiming that N.D. Tiwari was his biological father. The matter was agitated the original side of the Delhi High Court. I remember this, it was Justice Geeta Mittal, currently the CJ of Jammu and Kashmir, was the one who passed the order in the appeal, intra-court appeal, where she has ventured into a step ahead stating that the courts are not powerless to keep quiet when the respondent refuses to cooperate with the court in getting the blood samples or DNA samples collected. So the court has got every power to secure the presence of the respondent and compel him to get the gift samples. So this is the finding of the bench. It was challenged by N.D. Tiwari before the, I think it was challenged before the Supreme Court. And I find that for the first time, when the Supreme Court has chosen to dismiss the SLP, it has chosen to modify the order to some extent. Since the order was not reportable, the Supreme Court has caused the order that is challenged in appeal to be reported in the Supreme Court as a part and parcel of the Supreme Court judgment itself. You may find this in 2012, volume 12 SEC, page 555. 2012, volume 12 SEC, page 555. in Rohit Sheher versus ND Tiwari. It is a first appeal against FAO OS number 547 of 2011, dated 27-4-2012, Delhi High Court. This order was challenged. This order has been incorporated by the Supreme Court in 2012, 12 ECC, page 555, wherein the Supreme Court has upheld the order of the Division Bench of Delhi High Court. So the second question is answered in the sense that whenever there is a non-cooperation by the respondent, the courts are up to the issue of drawing an adverse inference, or in case if the judgment of the Delhi High Court is still holding roost, the court can take coercive steps to see that the presence of the respondent is secured. Third is the very important angle where I want to deliberate before concluding my remarks. This is a stage where the courts are in a quandary. Recently, in Madurai bench, a matter was filed, a revision by the wife, challenging the order of the trial court, which allowed the application for DNA test by the trial court. It's reported in 2019, volume 2 CTC, page 426. 2019, volume 2 CTC, page 426. G. Vasanthi versus M. Munishwaran. The interesting proposition in this matter is that the High Court was pleased to dismiss the CRP filed by the wife administrative level, where I initially was not in a position to comment the order, the single page, but reading of the reach of the judge again and again, I found an interesting what is called in the judgment. While listing the CRP, the administrative file petition and allowing the petitioner to undergo the what is called DNA test, the court in para 19 of the judgment has held as follows. I'll read if you don't mind. In the result, the order impugned in the CRP is sustained, but it is always open to the revision petitioner or wife to disregard the order passed by the court below requiring the holding of a DNA test. In that event, the allegation against her would be determined by the concerned court by drawing presumption of the nature contemplated in section 114 of the Indian Evidence Act, adverse inference. In other words, the court below will be justified in drawing adverse inference against revision petitioner. But the important point starts now. But then the issue of infidelity alone would be determined. The presumption enshrined in section 112 of the Evidence Act will not in any way be disturbed. I think the single judge has followed SNJ's mindset. The presumption enshrined in section 112 of the Indian Evidence Act will not in any way be disturbed. Neither the result of the DNA test nor adverse inference can lead to disclosing the conclusive proof contemplated by section 112 of the Evidence Act, so long as it remains in the current unamended form. I repeat once again, the presumption enshrined in section 112 of the Indian Evidence Act will not in any way be disturbed. Neither the result of the DNA test nor adverse inference can lead to disclosing the conclusive proof contemplated by section 112 of the Evidence Act, so long as there is in current under the court held, the rights of the child remain isolated and protected. While the father or mother may be exposed, the status of the child shall remain unstayed in law. If the result of the DNA deny the paternity of child, it shall be published just as identity of a pregnant and of a female in conflict with the law is concealed. Similar protective measures shall be taken in such cases. With the above observation, the CRP is dismissed, so on and so forth. Now, the question is, the Supreme Court has held in two cases that in case of clash of interest between the conclusive proof or the rebuttable presumption, and the scientific evidence, the latest judgment of the Supreme Court is in favor of scientific test. I would rely upon the judgment as SNJ has already has what is called relied upon, and NABC also relied upon. Nandlal Vasudev Badvaik, Nandlal Vasudev Badvaik versus Lata Nandlal Badvaik, reported in 2014, 5 CTC, page 680. Nandlal Vasudev Badvaik versus Lata Nandlal Badvaik and another, reported in 2014, 5 CTC, 680. I request the participants to go through para 17 and 18 of the judgment, which are very much instrumental in coming to a conclusion where the Supreme Court has given a particular finding, which is now lingering in my mind as to what could be the next scope of the law, march of law. In para 17, the Supreme Court says, we may remember that section 112 of the Evidence Act was enacted at a time when modern scientific advancement and DNA tests were not even in contemplation of the legislature. The result of DNA test is said to be scientifically accurate, although section 112 raises a presumption of conclusive proof on satisfaction of the conditions enumerated therein, but they may be rebutted. The presumption may offer legitimate means of arriving at an affirmative legal conclusion. While truth of facts known, in opinion, there is no need or for the presumption. Where there is evidence to the contrary, the presumption is rebuttable and it must yield to proof. Interest of justice is best served by ascertaining the truth, and the court should be furnished with the best available evidence, science, and may not be left to bank upon the presumptions unless science has no answer to the fact in issue. In our opinion, when there is a conflict between a conclusive proof, I repeat, in our opinion, when there is a conflict between a conclusive proof envisaged under the law and a proof based on scientific advancement accepted by the world community to be correct, when there is a conflict between a conclusive proof envisaged under law and a proof based on scientific advancement accepted by the world community to be correct, the latter must prevail over the former. Next paragraph is the area where I think we have to ponder more. Para 18, the Supreme Court says, we must understand the distinction between a legal fiction and the presumption of a fact. Legal fiction assumes existence of a fact which may not really exist. However, presumption of a fact depends on satisfaction of certain circumstances. Those circumstances logically would lead to a fact sought to be presumed. Section 112 of the Evidence Act does not fit a legal frame, but provides for presumption. This is the area where now we step up. In the 2003, ABJ pointed out, the 185th of the Court of the Commission of India submit a comprehensive report on the revamped evidence. It is not for Section 12 alone. Justice Jagannath Rao, one of the finest judges of the country, was the head of the Law Commission. He has filed a detailed report on the revamping of the Evidence Act. It was referred to an advisory committee of the parliament, and it has not seen the end of the tunnel even today. So the parliament has not cared to amend the law either on the basis of the corresponding international scenario, or at least in English laws, or on the basis of the report of the Law Commission of India, and the result of which now we are left with two extreme situations. On the one hand, we have an act which is not amended irrespective of a recommendation by the Law Commission. So we should construe that the amendment is not carried out conscientiously, or the Parliament is not inclined to amend the Act as of now. That could be the only inference we can draw, because the Parliament has not chosen to take into account the recommendation of the Law Commission. As SNJ has pointed out, the unamended evidence act is in the nature of protecting the interests of the child rather in the nature of seeing other aspects of dispute between the husband and wife in a maternity dispute or father and son or succession certificate or of any other 125 proceeding. Whereas the Supreme Court has given a judgment in what is called, I already told, the judgment of Nandlal was the Vaitik, which is a petition of section 20 years. Instantly, the same who was the judgment in the law case, Justice Kahir, sat with another judge and given subsequent judgment in Dipend with Roy versus Road Ratho Roy. Dipend with Roy versus Road Ratho Roy, 2014, CT 791. It came 6 months after the judgment of Nandlal's case. This is a case of matrimonial dispute. Nandlal case was under 125 CRPC. This case of Dipend with Roy was a matrimonial dispute where the crux was adultery. The husband has alleged that the child was not born to him. There was no access. He had raised the issue of the paternity and the court was inclined to allow the application. And by reiterating position of law in Sharda versus Dharampal and reiterating the judgment of the Supreme Court in Nandlal was those case, the petition was allowed and the appeal of the wife was finally rejected. So this is the situation where on the one hand, we have the unamended evidence act, which does not allow any evidence to dispel the conclusive proof. The word I insist upon is the fact that any evidence adduced by the petitioner who asserts the child is not born to him should have been taken to be the mode of what is called discharging the burden of proof. My humble opinion, I may be wrong, I am too small before all of you. My humble opinion is, had the Supreme Court had given this interpretation, that would have brought end to all the controversies. The Supreme Court would have easily interpreted a scientific test result would amount to an evidence of non-access. I don't find any embargo in Section 112 of the Evidence Act as of now, because Section 112 does not speak of any mode of discharge of burden of proof, as it is only a substantive law. We have got other procedural law to invoke to file an application. We cannot file an application seeking an expert opinion for DNA test under Section 112. We will have to invoke either 26 10A or purpose of appointing a commissioner to take a sample and send to the lab, or Section 75E or the appropriate provision. So my point is, in Section 112, Section 112 meets the petitioner who says the child is not born to him to be evidence of non-access. Why not a scientific test result be construed to be an evidence of non-access? If this is accepted either by the Supreme Court or by our High Court, I think there is no need to worry about the failure or inaction on the part of the lawmakers in amending the law. In fact, the amendment of the Law Commission came in, proposal came in 2003, where the committee has given 4 tests. Out of the 4 tests, if 2 is approved by the petitioner, it can be taken to be a proof of non-access. Again, the question of conclusive proof remains in the statute book under Section 112. So in my humble opinion, if the courts are going to adopt a stand stating that any scientific test result can be taken to be a mode of proof of non-access, the what is called the so-called dichotomy can be reconciled so easily. Before that, I want to rely upon 3 more judgments. Number one, I believe SNJ Comte D. Vespocham, 2001, 5EC, page 3, Comte D., where the Supreme Court has, as SNJ has correctly put out, Supreme Court has held the issue in favor of specific stated DNA result. There's no question of doubt accuracy, but unfortunately, the Supreme Court was of the view that a scientific test result cannot dislodge or dispel the conclusive proof drawn by the court. Again, the same has been followed by the Supreme Court in another case called Banarsidas versus Tiku Datta. Banarsidas versus Tiku Datta, 2005, 4 SEC, page 449. Banarsidas versus Tiku Datta, 2005, 4 SEC, page 449, where the question of issuance of succession certificate, where the paternity was issued, the Supreme Court followed Kamthi Devi and said a big no to DNA test, ultimately stating that it is not learned for the purpose of issuance of a succession certificate. Another case where a Supreme Court has given one test of imminent need. This judgment is not taken note by many of the judgments subsequently given. AIR 2010, Supreme Court, page 2851. AIR 2010, Supreme Court, page 2851. Bhavani Prasad Zina. Bhavani Prasad Zina versus Orissa State Commission for Women. This is a case where Section 125 CRPC was invoked. The husband would not have paid the amount suspecting the paternity of the child. What happened? The State Commission for Women at Orissa has suyamoto taken cognizance, and the Women Commission has directed a DNA test. That was under challenge by the wife, where the Supreme Court has it's called imminent test in paragraph number 15. This is Lodha, as is then in the beach along the this is Satab, and in paragraph 12, he even would reason. I will come paragraph 10 after paragraph, where Justice Lodha has held recently in the case of Ram Kanya versus Bharatram, decided by the bench of in which one of us was the member, Justice Lodha, the order of the High Court directing DNA of the child at the instance of the husband was set aside, and it was held that the High Court was not justified in allowing the application for grant of DNA of the child on the ground that there will be possibility of reunion of the parties if such DNA was conducted, and if it was found from the outcome of the DNA that the son was born out of the wedlock. So that cannot be a binding precedent for us. In paragraph 13, the Supreme Court said, in a matter where paternity of a child is an issue before the court, the use of DNA is an extremely delicate and sensitive aspect. One view is that when modern science gives means of ascertaining the paternity of a child, there should not be any hesitation to use whenever the occasion requires. The other view is that the court must be reluctant in use of such scientific advances and tools which result in invasion of right of privacy of an individual and may not only be prejudicial to the rights of the parties, but may have devastating effect on the child. Harping much on the bastardization of the child, the court said DNA linked to parenting of a child should not be directed by the court as a matter of course in a routine manner. When such a request is made, the court has to consider diverse aspects, including presumption and reduction only of the Evidence Act, pros and cons of such order, and the test of imminent need, whether it is not possible for the court to reach the truth without use of such test may be adopted. So the Supreme Court has not ruled out against DNA test. The Supreme Court in Bhavani Prasad case say, in case if you are able to apply imminent need, the DNA test may be followed. And finally, there is one more case of Supreme Court in 2010, volume 11 SEC, page 483, Bharata Mata versus Vijaya Ranganathan. Bharata Mata versus Vijaya Ranganathan, 2010, 11 SEC, page 483, where it is a suit for partition where the paternity was an issue. Since the parties were Hindus, the Supreme Court invoked Section 16 of the Hindu Marriage Act, which says that a son or child born out of a void marriage is also presumed to be a legitimate children and they got a right over the self-occupied property of the parents. So these are all the judgments of the Supreme Court where there is a divergent view. If one person is of the view that the 2014 judgment of Supreme Court of Justice Keher in Nandlal's case has not taken into account the previous judgments, they are not correct because Justice Keher has discussed all the previous case laws while delivering Nandlal case and stated that none of the cases previously decided were in the nature of testing the conflict between the conclusive proof and the scientific evidence. So as I already stated, we are between two options. One is the unamended provision of Section 112 of the Evidence Act, where once a presumption is raised, in the absence of any contra evidence in the mode known to law, the court is bound to draw a conclusive proof. There can be no rebuttal or contra evidence. On the other hand, the Supreme Court says the law of the Supreme Court is binding all over the country under Article 141. So now we are having two options, which is to be followed. Either the letter and spirit of Section 112 of the Evidence Act or judgment of Supreme Court under Article 141. Here lies the judgment of the single bench of Madurai High Court. Justice G.R. Swaminathan has delivered the order where he has made a distinction that even in the case of such proof is available, if it is against the can be taken proof of infidelity for the purpose of deciding the issue of dissolution of marriage, the child's birth should not be pasteurized. But the issue is infidelity is followed by presumption of paternity also. So my simple request to the judges is to contemplate two aspects. I'm just throwing it as a debatable point in the open forum. Number one, is it possible to permit any scientific test as a proof of non-access without amending the Evidence Act, or at least till the Act is amended? If it is permissible, we are not bothered about the unamended Evidence Act. We can follow the law depending upon each and every circumstance of the case, depending upon the nature of evidence available. We can decide the matter on issue to issue basis. Number two, if for some reason we hold that DNA test or scientific test cannot be introduced as a matter of receiving of what is called evidence of non-access, I think unless the Act is amended, there will be a confusion in the minds of the lower judiciary at least as to which course is to follow. With this, I conclude my remarks. Thank you, sir, both of you, for giving a very illustrious and heartbreaking abuse. Thank you, sir.
Sir, this is Anand. Do you want to say anything, or shall I say?
You please say, sir.
Yes. So far, I want to take only 2-3 minutes. So far, we expressed by Mr. Srinivasa Raghavan that Section 112 speaks only of very valid marriage. Now, this is to be interpreted. I think that this has been interpreted. So before 1956, any child born out of a void marriage is not legitimate. It was only in 1956 Act, the law has been made that a child born out of a void marriage is also a legitimate child. Therefore, the term valid marriage as stated in Section 112 should be read down as...
Read down.
Any marriage. Yes, it should be read down. So. Yes, it may be as it was rightly suggested by him, in order to remove the confusion, either it may be amended to say that either valid marriage, void marriage, or voidable marriage. So it can be so stated to remove the missing any doubt on this. Otherwise, in my view, that the term valid marriage is to be read as valid, void, and voidable marriage for the purpose of Section 112. Okay, in view of Section 16 of the Hindu Marriage Act. That is one thing I want to say. Number two, and Mr. Srinivasa Raghavan further said that the law is being changed in the Western world, but we are not changing that. My view is that society in the Western countries is totally different, and our society our institution of marriage are all completely Indian. They are all celebrated by those people. So we cannot change. We cannot change the law, which is suitable for the Western world. Ours is a distinct society. We have got so many moral values, and we have to follow. So far, say, let us not borrow everything from the Western world. Ours is a different society. You know what is happening in US? 18 years, as soon as the boy completes 18 years of age, he is thrown out of the family. But still, we have got this co-partnery system. We have got the joint family system. Our society is different. So therefore, let us not borrow all those things from the Western world. And regarding his viewpoint, the DNA can be one of the modes to prove non-excess. I have, in an earlier speech also, I have said that the DNA can be permitted as a tool to prove non-excess. Okay, I fully agree with him, but in my view, it should not be a routine affair. That is why the Supreme Court is much worried about that, because the Supreme Court has regard for the societal interest and the interest of the child. So it's a balancing act. Therefore, the Supreme Court is also worried as to how to balance it when the science is so much developing. How to at the same time preserve the fabric of the society? That is a concern of the Supreme Court. That is why these problems. Then referring to Article 21, Mr. Srinivas Raghavan said that testimonial compulsion, because it's not a criminal case. Article 21, right to life. So all these things have been now closed by the Supreme Court. So Article 21 will come only when you are permitted to lead evidence. So we are at a threshold. When you are not permitted to lead any evidence, where is the question of invoking Article 21? If only the person is permitted to lead evidence, ignoring the bar in Section 112, then he can go to Article 21 as a defense husband may take or anybody may take. So that is not the case now. So my humble view is this. So societal interest or social fabric ought to be preserved, and the law can be interpreted. Even Section 112 may be amended. I got no grievance over that. But at the same time, the purpose for which Section 112 was enacted in the law, which was a very laudable one, cannot be simply destroyed by means of amendment. With this, I conclude. Thank you very much, Mr. Srinivas Raghavan, sir, for
having me. So, Srinivas, viewers have anything to say?
Mr. Venkatraman?
Namaste to all the three of you. It was such a delightful 2.5 hours to learn so much from each one of you. It was such a delight, especially for a man who does not know this law at all. I have one doubt, sir. Anybody can clarify it.
Yes.
See, the morality basis is certainly a strong aspect from the Indian point of view, and we should have that. Now, whether any other collateral law which you have been deliberating upon, are we vulnerable for an attack under the collateral law, whether it's diverse or it's a suit, then what happens to the exposure under 112? Is it a dichotomy that Srini also raised? What can be the solution as learned judges? Should everything be aligned with 112, or we are now partially opening an attack, and therefore all these subjective tests, scientific tests, and we have all people who have worked a lot in on test reports. Machine always gives you the right report, but not the men who man the machines also. So everywhere there can be an area of suspicion and doubt if litigating parties are going to take things beyond a point. So is there a foolproof ceiling in the respective collateral laws to ensure 112 is not made vulnerable? That's the only doubt I have as a man who does not know much of criminal law or this aspect of evidence. I'll just leave it there.
Sir, you please kindly see, we are saying that as when the law was enacted, namely in 1872, these scientific methods were not available. So you please kindly consider as to what was there in the mind of the lawmaker. He did not speak of access to be proved. You forget about Section 112. Let us say that 112 is not there. Then what would have been the burden of the wife? The burden of the wife would have been to prove the excess. Okay? So 112, they incorporated only to relieve the wife from that burden. So they declared that a child was born only to this man. So even the only exemption given in section 112 is not to disprove the access. You just see the word, word used. It is only to prove non-access. In my perception, it makes all the difference. Proof of non-access is one thing. Disproof of access is something different. If you go to section 3, proved, disproved and not proved, when the question of disproof will come. So that will go, that this will throw a lot of light on that. So this declaration made under section 112 of the Evidence Act not only preserve the fabric of the society interest of the child, and it also plays a vital role in many other laws, like Succession Act for the purpose of divorce, adoption, so many things. Therefore, when section 112 was incorporated, it is not as though there was no other method to prove. Paternity test, blood test was there, so many things. We have paternity test before DNA were also done by this court, by on the orders of the court. Mm-hmm. So therefore, the purpose for which section 112 was incorporated cannot be forgotten, is my view.
I think
Mr. Venkatraman, I think one more thing which you can keep in mind is, you were concerned about whether 112 is the only method where is it possible that in the collateral enactments whether there will be a conflict, right?
Yes sir.
Basically any collateral proceedings, like in the case of 125 CRPC, like in the case of proceedings under the for partition, case of declaration of status, etc., all these proceedings happen by way of a judicial proceedings before a court of law. So when this happens by way of judicial proceedings before a court of law, when this becomes a fact in issue, then the operation of the Indian Evidence Act starts operating. So once that happens, when it comes to the legitimacy of a child, then necessarily 112 will have to be employed. Thank you.
Thank you, Venkat. Sir, may I move to Chitra Sampath, please? Chitra, madam?
No, I thought I will just join the queue and say that 112 is self-contained and doesn't require any modification. Being a trial lawyer, I thought I'll put in my inputs.
No, I got one vote in my favor.
See, it's like this. Yes. The opening section 112 itself says the fact that any person, so it is a fact, the fact that any person was born during the continuance of a valid marriage, as the Lord has rightly put, that valid marriage has to be expanded regarding abreast with the march of law between a mother, his mother, and any man. So it doesn't speak about the husband. So it means it can be only a valid marriage and a valid husband. Only that fact will be conclusive proof, but it doesn't say that will be conclusive proof forever. It is always put rider under the next clause. So next clause says, it says that it can have no access to each other. So no access means that he never had any possibility of any having any sexual intercourse with his wife. That can be proved only by medical evidence. That is implied in that. I don't know why they got confused with Article 21 and this and that, because no access, yes, if I'm going to have a different passport, I'm outside the country, no access can be readily presumed and proved. But if I'm going to be living the same house also, I can still remain away from her or away from my wife. So in those cases, the only possible way in which a person can prove no access is only by medical evidence, by the examination of both the parties. So it is implied in 112. It doesn't say medical evidence, but it is the only way in which the president, we can prove that case before the trial court. So once a person is able to show that he had no access to her, and he insists that there should be a medical evidence in support of that, the court has to go in his favor, because otherwise he's denied the right to prove his case under the second limb of 112. That is my view.
No, you are right. That is what I also said. What I said was, but the court should be very cautious. Not in every case court can simply order. So even to make out a case to send for DNA, the party should make out some foundation facts he has to make out.
Correct. So, see, it is like this.
So, because yes. It is a very
suppose
issue.
Yeah. The man has been living with the wife and the children for several years, and at the age when she files a divorce petition, then he disowns the child. Then it will mean, then the court can refuse it, saying you have accepted and acknowledged him to be your child, then you cannot go for a DNA test. Suppose he comes immediately after conceiving itself, he comes with a case of infidelity, then it is a case where it is a right to go for a DNA test. Not in all cases, because once a man has acknowledged that child as his and he has lived with the child, he cannot be allowed to have a DNA access.
Absolutely.
That may be the way in which the trial.
Absolutely, this is my view.
Sudarshana Manivannan. Sudarshana?
Good afternoon, your lordships. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. I just have two questions in this regard, your lordship. One is that when section 112 is revamped or amended or removed, assuming so, will that not increase the multiplicity of suits? Because as we know, divorce proceedings and custody proceedings tend to get extremely ugly in court. And every time a husband hesitates to pay maintenance to his wife, he is immediately going to file a DNA test questioning the birth of his child. This might prove to be an extremely humiliating process for the woman, and it might also stop them from coming forward in filing any sort of cases before the court, your lordships. And secondly, there was Honorable Justice Anand Venkatesh J pointed out that the act was introduced, 112 was introduced in 1872. Therefore, that was at a point where scientific developments were, we could not even fathom that we could identify a person's paternity through DNA. And that was at a point where we did not know about the various scientific developments that would take place. But your lordship, the recent bills, the Assisted Reproductive Technology Bill of 2014, the Surrogacy Regulations Bill of 2019, and recently the DNA Technology Application Bill of 2019, those bills still presume the paternity and legitimacy in favor of the intending parents or the in favor of the commissioning couple, your lordships. Moreover, in section 34 of the proposed DNA regulation bill, your lordship, the bill states that any information regarding the DNA samples and DNA profiling can be made available for judicial proceedings in accordance with the rules of admissibility of evidence. According to my limited understanding of the section, it clearly states that this will be in accordance with section 112 of the Indian Evidence Act. Because
you are absolutely correct. We can't it is subject to section 112.
112, your lordship. Yes, your lordship. Provided there is also a schedule given to the regulation bill, your lordship, where in schedule there's a part C which talks about the list of matters that can be given for DNA testing. So schedule C states that DNA identification technology can be availed even in civil disputes and other civil matters. It includes parental disputes, and it includes issues relating to surrogacy and in vitro fertilization, etc., your lordship. Hence,
everything is subject to 112. You already come to that conclusion. You are absolutely correct. So far the first question is concerned, it is our apprehension also, because in every case, in a routine question, a disgruntled husband will come and make an application in any proceeding disputing the paternity. That's the reason why we say that section 112 should not be amended. It should be there in the statute book. And we also further say that, as it was pointed by Madam Chitra Sambar, there is a way for a real litigant to prove non-access. That is one of the scientific ways is DNA. So, but as I said, you have to make it a very strong case before asking for DNA. One has to make it a very strong case. Then only DNA can be ordered. This is the position. We fully agree with you all your review points. Thank you.
Move to Jesse Jivapriya. Jesse Jivapriya.
Good afternoon, Millard. My doubt is regarding access, that the term access. But if a child is born out of embryo donation, then mother egg won't be there, father sperm won't be there. Because someone's embryo will be donated and the child will be born. Then DNA test also, there won't be any help. And how to prove this? Even if the access is proved or not proved, because the sperm doesn't belong to him. shall that child, then how to correlate with section 112? Because nowadays infertility increases, so parents are mandatorily moved to the scientific method.
Madam, as you know, yes. Till now at least it is the law of contract that is governing all these things. It all depends upon the type of agreement that has been made between the parties. If the husband yes. is well aware of the fact that they have agreed, there are documents which are signed by them. If he is aware of the fact that the child was born through a sperm which was donated by somebody and through which his wife has begotten and delivered a child, then insofar as the legitimacy of the child is concerned, this man cannot disown it. This is like an adoptive father case. This man can never disown it. So therefore, insofar as the legitimacy is concerned, obviously the mother and the man who had consented for it are the parents of the child.
Section 112 will be applicable. That is what.
Yes. How to take a conclusive proof?
That is why I am saying access must be given a completely different, perspective. Completely different. See, access to start with was only having a very limited meaning, that access of two physical bodies. Yes. Today, the access has to be interpreted very differently, as we said, access of the sperm and the womb. So there can be a further march of law in interpreting the word access also. Access can also be the access of the knowledge of this man for consenting to have his wife conceived through the donated form of somebody. So the word access must be defined in such a way that it is in line with the present day scientific development. That's important.
Then, my lord, amendment is necessary, my lord.
I think, I also do fall in line with the view taken by Honorable Justice Anand, that the word access should be so interpreted to include this case also. I fully agree with your view. So section 112, that is the reason why that section 112 should be preserved. Correct.
Thank you, my lord.
Yes,
sir.
Yes. Sir, I reiterate my doubt to both your lordships, sir. In the unamended form, can't we include a DNA test or any other test to be a proof of non-access?
Yes, certainly.
Certainly.
The report has not closed the door for the DNA. DNA is very much available. It can be done, but we cannot have it in just like that for mere asking.
Broadly, we are in agreement with two or three propositions here. Yes, one is, till the parliament in its wisdom, legislature in its wisdom, wants to amend 112, we have to manage with the prevailing provision.
Provision. Yes.
So, how do we manage becomes the important question.
Yes.
So, how do we manage will all depend upon the meaning that we are going to assign to this word access.
Access.
The access as it was understood when the enactment came into force, the same understanding should not continue. Of course, that is the basis. But now, the access must be given a even more elaborate meaning to bring within it access of a sperm and ovum, access of a knowledge where a person allows his wife to get injected with the sperm of somebody else. So you have to broaden the meaning of the term access. So therefore, that will also mean that where you have to prove no access in such circumstances, automatically the scientific things will start coming in. To prove non-access, then DNA will come. So therefore, with the available provision, it is possible that we will be able to balance it by retaining the provision as it is and giving it a important meaning, taking into consideration the scientific developments that have taken place. Provided it cannot be done in a very routine manner, there must be a strong case that has to be made out before the court before resorting to any such scientific methods. That becomes very important. I think broadly, this is how we may have to conclude the proceedings.
Declared by law. What is declared by law? Law declares by means of section 112 the legitimacy of the child. The child was born to so-and-so. So whatever is the consequence arising out of that, be it civil law, criminal law, civil rights, criminal prosecution, all will follow thereafter.
Such a fantastic experience, and it was such a delight to be part of this session.
Thank you, Anyabiji sir. Thank you, Sunji sir, for the
thank you. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thanks.